my lovely little gemstones, it's Afira, and today I'll be reading Self-Love Chapter 5 by Parallel Monsoon. Quick warning for this chapter, there is body horror and graphic descriptions of dead bodies. Chapter 5, Remus. The lights flicker. Blood oozes down the walls. A thick gout of it splashes from the ice maker and puddles on the kitchen tiles, spreading in tiny tendrils across the grout. There's a wet penny stench, more a taste than a smell, thick enough to chew. Somewhere far away there's a hum, a distant feast of flies. Thomas sighs. Remus, he greets, and as the blood wavers and fades, he makes a note to sweep the floor. For a moment he's left in peace, just long enough to make him suspicious, and Thomas cranes his neck back to look behind himself with flinching caution. It's not entirely a surprise to see two eyes floating there, the optic nerves twining and writhing like mating snakes. Underneath hangs a disembodied, too wide smile, complete with slick gums and a waggling tongue. Remus resolves into the world in layers, a tree root network of arteries and veins, organs that pulsate and glisten, lush, wet muscle. How's that for an entrance? Remus crows. The last of his skin crawls up his neck to cover the red planes of his face as he spins, arms outstretched, triumphant and entirely too pleased with himself. Thomas slaps a hand over his eyes. Clothes, he grinds out. Remus snorts, but Thomas hears the rustle of fabric and chances a peek. Booty shorts and a crop top. He'll take it. Thank you, he manages. He already knows he'll dream of it later. The slow-motion slither of the intestines, the heavy brown pouch of the stomach, the lungs, walnuts shriveled and then straining taut. It's not like you haven't seen it before, Remus throws himself across the table, leaving his head to dangle over the edge. Unless, do you close your eyes in the shower? That's a good way to slip, you know. He brightens, rolls onto his belly, hands clasped under his chin and legs kicking in the air, and Thomas braces himself. You could crunch up your spine like a pretzel! Ooh! He giggles, high-pitched, merry and bright, and very nearly sweet, and Thomas wishes it were an uglier sound. Or jam the shower thingy right up your nose and into your brain. What a way to go! It would all be bad enough if it were just words, but Thomas can't help but picture it. His own limp corpse, open, glazed eyes, blue skin, stiffening limbs, the strange, twisted hunch of his neck, the dark blood clots clustered in the drain. Who knew that a vivid imagination could be as much a curse as a blessing? I don't mind looking at myself, Thomas protests, because apparently being called a never-nude prude was the most distressing part of what just happened. Remus rolls his eyes so hard they go skittering across the floor. For some reason, it's the little damp blotches they leave behind that makes Thomas gag. It's not the same, Thomas says. And why is he arguing about this? You aren't me. Eh. Remus rolls his shoulders and winks one empty eye socket. Close enough. Forget the meaty lump of the liver and the pink apostrophes of the kidneys. There's the real nightmare fuel right there. Thomas tips his head back to stare at the ceiling, takes a dozen slow, steadying breaths. When he looks back again, Remus is pacing, round and round the table, shoes squelching with each step. He judders sometimes, fades and reforms, and almost glitches. He's never quite as solid as the others, never quite settled fully into the world. Thomas has never been sure if it's just his nature or if it's Thomas's own doing, an unconscious attempt to force Remus out of reality. He wonders if it hurts. Roman isn't coming, is he? Thomas says. Remus stills. And that's terrifying in itself, because Remus is never still. He turns his head to look at Thomas. Slowly, with all the dramatic flair he shares with his brother, and his eyes are cold and hard and feral. Wolf's eyes, cat's eyes, the eyes of something that hunts lean for its dinner. He smiles, and Thomas shudders. Thomas knows how this works. He knows that Remus can't hurt him, not really. And yet, Thomas rarely thinks of his body. He despairs over it, sometimes, or in rare moments delights in it, but for the most part he simply lives in it. His center, the part he thinks of as him, is somewhere else. But under Remus's flint-shard gaze, Thomas knows himself to be meat. He is a squishy thing, frail and all too easily torn wide. He is prey, and across the room the predator drools silver and licks his lips. Thought you calling. Remus strums his fingers against his chest. Knew you didn't want me, but dear little Roman is indisposed at the moment. He twists a hand, batters his way in, and Thomas squeezes his eyes closed, even though he knows it's pointless. It takes a moment to make sense of it. Roman, shattered to pieces, a frostfurred, messy spill of parts. his face carved from his skull like a mask, and the worst part is how peaceful he looks, lips curved gently in an almost smile. A flash like sunlight through closed eyes, and there's Roman again, whole and curled fetal, arms up to cover his head. A Roman made of ash and dust, and Thomas thinks of Pompeii, of the thunder that swept down and turned a quiet day into fury. Stop! Thomas is on the floor. Thomas is sobbing until he's sick with it, scrambling up to spit bile into the sink. Stop, he whispers, even though Remus already has. Remus grins. Or maybe it's a snarl, or maybe it's a frown. He's stuttering harder now, there and then not quite, and it makes Thomas's head throb to look at him. Thomas starts to call for Logan. Logan will talk him through this. He'll reassure Thomas that Roman is whole. Not dust, not frozen and shattered and left to melt messy. He'll tell Thomas the truth. Go ahead, Remus says, and it's almost a hiss. Let him get that out of your head. Except Remus already has told him the truth, hasn't he? Not the truth, maybe, but a truth. I'm worried about him too. Remus's face twists into something complicated, something that weds grief and anger with smugness and reluctant pleasure. It's stupid anyway, he mutters. Psycho Godfather Wars. Does that sound like a you thing? He makes a show of looking Thomas up and down. Mr. Too Good for Snot was gonna help you play a gangster? He cackles at the idea of it. And in all honesty, it's a fair enough point. Thomas had never really felt confident that they would have gotten the part. It was so far outside his wheelhouse that it might as well have been on Mars. I guess I would have needed you both, he says. There's a crack and a deafening flare of static, and Remus is gone. Thomas doesn't call him back. He is afraid that Roman will feel it if he does, and think himself replaced. It gives him time to think, in any case, about Roman and Remus, and how his own child self had shaped who they were allowed to be. They'd never had a choice. But then, Thomas hadn't either, because when you're small, so much of what you know is given to you. His teachers had praised his stories of fairy unicorns and adventuring squires, while his painstakingly illustrated tale of fratricide had landed him in the counselor's office. He tries to be gentle with himself for taking so long to realize that glory in gray. He doesn't have to wait long for Remus to show his face again. He never does. It's a staring day, he seems, and Thomas doesn't much mind those. I'm glad you're here, he says, and has to hide a grin at the way Remus falters mid-chew, cheeks bulging with deodorant. I want to write a story, and could use your help. Remus forces a too-wet swallow. You want to write a story? He echoes, and he's got that feral look again, like he suspects Thomas is mocking him and fully intends to end him if he is. With me. Thomas nods and reaches for a handy notepad. Let's... He hums, thinking. Snaps his fingers as inspiration strikes, pen already poised. Tell me about the bird. Straight from the nest and into a jet turbine. At the time, Thomas had been busy being disgusted for his morality's sake, but let's face it, that shit is hilarious. Hilarious and awful, and it just gets worse from there. The jet plows into a train that derails into the White House, a twisted butterfly flaps its wings scenario. Except the butterfly is a fledgling sparrow, and instead of a tornado, it ends with everything, absolutely everything, on fire. By the last page, Thomas's belly hurts from laughing. It's gross and gruesome and so over the top that he can't possibly take it seriously. And then, the nun- Enough! Enough! Thomas shakes out his aching wrist and holds up both hands in a plea for mercy. Let's hold that thought for next time. He doesn't realize what he's asking until he's already said it. Cringes a bit, fully expecting Remus to ramble on all the louder. But Remus just grins, and his eyes are shining, and he looks so much like Roman on his best days that Thomas feels his heart twist tight. Twins. Reflections in a funhouse mirror. But the thing about those is that despite the long legs or tiny torso, what you see is still you. Different, save for all the ways that they're the same. Good job. Thomas offers a fist bump, and graciously pretends not to notice that Remus looks like he might, well, cry. And then they actually do make contact. And right, Thomas keeps forgetting that's new, and it's a good 20 minutes before he can convince Remus to stop poking at him. The story grows, page after page of mayhem and terror, and all the while Thomas learns. He learns that Remus, even more than Virgil, craves touch. He wants to be close to Thomas, always. At first, it's 18 kinds of awkward, but he gets used to having Remus plastered to his side, even gets used to the hot sulfur reek of him. He wants to be held, but he also wants to move, always fidgeting, bouncing his legs and tapping his fingers against Thomas's ribs, until finally he explodes, only sometimes literally, flying up to Pace, juddering and glitching and nearly growling from the strain of it. "Does that hurt?" Thomas finally asks. "Like ants nesting in my marrow," Remus says cheerfully. There's a day when Remus can't seem to stop himself, just circles like a rabid dog chasing its own tail, and with every step he's a little more out of sync, a little more to the left of the world. Thomas has to look away, and even the flashes of rotten decay and maggots are easier on the eye. Until finally, Thomas can't stand another moment of it. He stands, eyes still closed, and catches Remus by the arm on his next pass, pushes him down flat on the couch, ignoring his protests and wriggling. "One sex joke and we're done for the day," he says, and simply lays flat on top of him. "Oh," Remus says, and his voice is surprised and very small. Thomas grins. The next day, Thomas gives him a fidget cube, and regrets it instantly, bitterly, because the clicking is frantic and never stops. And of course, once Remus has the concept down, he has to improve it, and instead of clicking, it squawks or farts or shoots streams of slime. Thomas swears he'll hear it in the grave. 6 feet down, and there will still be the clicking, the squeaking, the burping. It makes him want to scream. Remus doesn't stutter when he's clicking. Maybe because the cube started off as something real, something tangible, and its once reality helps to tether him. Maybe because it was a gift, and in giving it, Thomas crossed some threshold, found some level of acceptance in a deep-down, hidden place. Thomas grits his teeth and never says a word. He learns that if he spends time with Remus, things get easier. Easier, not easy. He'll always have intrusive thoughts. Thomas has accepted that by now, just as he's accepted his anxiety. But those thoughts get just a little quieter, a little less personal. He thinks, "I wonder if I'd bounce if I fell, instead of jump." He sees a blink flash of a broken, twisted body, but it's just that, a body. A stranger instead of his brother or of his mother, and that counts for something. But there are days when Remus is still, days when he huddles against the arm of the couch and snarls a warning when Thomas tries to touch him, and those are the days when the thoughts are not just personal, but pointed. Thomas sees Joan, drowned and bloated, black tongue lolling. He sees his father hammering desperate at the car windows as the engine catches fire. He sees the people he loves suffering, and he listens to what Remus can't bring himself to say. "I know," he tells him. "I'll fix it. I'm not sure how, but I promise I will." And between it all, the hugs with Patton, the talks with Logan, the cuddles with Virgil, and the stories with Remus, Thomas talks to Janice. Thank you all so much for listening. Make sure to like, comment, and subscribe, and if you like what you hear and you want to read more, you can find the link to the fic in the description. If you want to check out other podfics I've done, you can click on the playlist of my videos linked on the screen. See you next time!